Allahu 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 Allah Allahu 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 Allah
Allah
Allah. And that is how to prevent child abuse and how to react if it happens in your school. How to prevent child abuse in school and how to react if it happens. So this is the topic. Everyone clear on this? Okay. Is it a reality in our schools? Is it a reality? Child abuse, is it a reality? Or is it a very, very, very uncommon thing? It's a reality. The times will be different. Okay. It happens and it's a reality, and you know Brother Sami, we have been discussing this in our meetings at FAIL, how these things happen. So I'll initiate the discussion with you, Brother Sami. How to prevent it? Is it possible to prevent it?
This is a very serious issue, and not only in Islamic schools, it is there in all the schools, okay, in irrespective. Now, just two tips is from my side. I'll pass on the mic. The first thing is you should have, and more so, yes, it is. If it doesn't come to your knowledge as a owner, please don't think it is not happening. Okay, it is very prevalent now because of various influences that are happening. So one is have a very good counselor, a trained counselor, certified counselor. And more who are done for the child as a child psychologist. And the second very important thing is you need to have a very good monitoring mechanism. CCTV itself installed doesn't solve the purpose. You should have a very hawk-eye approach that every child is safe and make sure that there are certain SOP, standard operating procedures where. You don't allow a student to go alone in places like restrooms, in places where big halls. So these are all certain SOPs you need to follow, and inshallah if you do that.
So three important points, Aki. One you said was a counselor. Second you said was SOP. And third you said was?
Monitoring. Have SOPs and
monitoring and okay, but when you say counseling, is it only for the students? Can it be also for the teachers?
So we normally take counselors for the students, but for us they have been useful for the staff and also for the parents. Okay, so more importantly here is the child, but they can be used for staff and also for the parents.
Right. So counseling, SOP and monitoring. These are the three key points that you have to, inshallah, build on and implement as an institution. Dr. Saeed, your take on this.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. JazakAllah for taking up this issue to a very sensitive.
Right.
See, at present, according to the research, in India, every day, 20 children commit suicide. Every day, school-going children commit suicide in India. Apart from this, 20 to 25% of teachers are coming from the area of either they are divorcees, single, separated, or living in without husband or without wife. 20 to 25% school-going children are coming from single-parent families. We are totally in an emotional disturbed society. With all this, you know, disturbances mentally and emotionally, there are some kind of exploitation. More than physical, it is emotional exploitation. Like as you said, it's not, but when I take this advantage of my being, its age and experience to express it with more detail, it's not among the students the exploitation is going on, among the teachers. A young 22, 23 years aged lady teacher, you know, she exploits a young boy of 18 years aged. Okay, this is also exploitation. It's not about from the teachers, it's about the male teachers, about students and teachers. So all this is going on, but as he rightly said, pointed out, we need to create a mechanism to find out the reasons and identify it and create a system to protect both our children and the teachers.
Right, I mean, you've highlighted in fact another aspect to it. We are just not talking of child abuse, it can be teachers also who can get abused. And as you said, emotionally disturbed backgrounds, or students who come from emotionally disturbed backgrounds are more prone to being exploited by the teachers and so on and so forth. Right? So this is a reality that we have to face. So do you recommend that this counseling, as Brother Sami Mulla mentioned, counseling has to be widespread and in a more broader manner?
More than the counseling, you know, the value system has to be there.
Value system has to be there. Okay, fine. So this is
some kind of, you know, some boundaries.
Right. So this is again a wide subject. I mean, schools should take this up and have workshops being conducted for over a longer period of time.
If you say counseling, the parents will get alert. No, what is wrong with my children? You say it's mentoring, one-to-one.
Mentoring.
You know, mentoring.
So it has to be prevention. The parents also have to be advised. Prevention is better than cure. Right?
Yes.
So just don't wait for it to happen. You have to prevent it happening. So these
counseling
are the mechanisms.
Counseling happens once you identify the affected child.
Okay.
But mentoring is a kind of, you know, prerequisite.
MashaAllah, that's a good point. Right. Okay. Brother Hassan, you've heard the discussion so far. What are your comments?
One of my research paper presented in ISNA, Chicago, has discussed detail on issues of child abuse in Islamic schools, especially Islamic schools. So they have come up with the point, five types of abuses happen in Islamic schools. One is physical abuse, one is emotional abuse, and you have sexual abuse, then you have substance abuse, where they're exposed to drugs, and as well as they are neglected.
Islamic schools,
which
is on schools.
No, his
research is.
The research paper is based on Islamic schools in ISNA, South America.
Okay.
So I just, I brought this to make this, since we are running Islamic schools, and there is a paper presented on this. According to Indian according to the Indian report, on normal Islamic school, it is 57% of children, they are exposed to any kind of abuse. It can be physical abuse, it can be emotional abuse, it can be to substance abuse, any kind of abuse. Now, how do we want to tackle this? First, it happens, it speaks a lot about the culture of the school. What is the culture of the school? What are the value systems? What are the monitoring systems of your school? That will help you. For example, is there any system where a child can walk to the principal room without any hesitation and report this, I have been abused? Is there any system? So that is how the culture should be there, where everybody has a word to say. Either it can be a parent, it can be a teacher, it can be any stakeholder. So that will reduce most of the problems of abuses, number one. Number two, the solution part is making awareness among the stakeholders. For example, one of the children, child might not be able to report to the teacher or report to the parent. Somewhere or the other, it has an impact. So when it comes to impact, it has a lot of impacts, which will be, if time permits, we will be discussing if the question comes. But is there anything which can be heard, or is it monitoring tracked properly to the child, what's happening? When this, one of the impacts is, if any kind of abuse has been affected by the child, it has a physical impact, emotional impact, lot of impacts which can be identified any of the stakeholders of the school. It can be a teacher, it can be a principal, it can be a parent, or anybody, any neighbor as well. So a lot of things which is not identified by the teacher, but a neighbor can tell you this child has been abused. So this is what I have.
Right. So basically, you've identified different kinds of abuses that can happen, and it all starts again, as Dr. Saeed was pointing out, having some kind of mechanisms and systems in place.
And the culture of the school.
So can I ask you, just to prolong, take it in a different light, we have orphanages and we have so many cases. It's a reality. It's a hard reality, whether we accept it or we don't, right? So does that percolate down somehow to the Islamic schools? It's happening there. We know, okay? Not only in our community, to be what Dr. Saeed pointed out, we know other communities and what's happening at the top level there. And now recently they've come out openly about it and speaking of it and so on. But it is a reality now of villages too. So does it, because when I'm sort of exposed to those schools and interacting with them and associated with them, okay, these are cases which somehow have come in because of the culture, something or the other there. So would you like to comment on that and how we can prevent that, put a filter so that it doesn't happen?
See, my experience is much larger in non-Islamic schools.
Okay.
Not that I'm not doing for Islamic schools, yes. My 80% of my time goes to non-Muslim schools and 20% is more because of my association. Now, let me speak in general. I think doctors speak in specific. Now, what we need to do, I was, one of my clients got involved in this. It's a non-Muslim school. It was one of the biggest cases in the history of India, and it's the first case. So he is one of my clients. Instead of going in the background, what I suggest is you need to do a proper process of getting the staff. What kind of staff you are getting? The check has to be very good. If you can, you cannot just say that that particular teacher was studying in a previous school and so-called good school and I poach. But you should know the character of that. Irrespective, I'm talking not about the Muslim schools per se, irrespective. So I have seen the background checks, and those are very, very important if you are taking staff, and staff more so if it is in the less than 7th grade. At least above 8th, the child may go and tell me again. Okay. I recently had in my own office, I had a colleague of mine whose child was getting sexually harassed at home, okay, for 2 years. And she discussed with the teacher and it came up to the management, okay, and the manager spoke to my colleague. Now, if we have a good counselor, it not only helps in the school, also what is happening outside the school. Now, overall, since your question was to do with the staff, I am again saying the background check is very, very important. Yes, the background of the person may be from some madaris or some ijara, but that is not only for that, it's for all staff is what my take is.
So there is a need, people who are your stakeholders, okay, we should have some kind of a certifying agency, a central agency that can certify a particular person coming from a particular background and is safe. Some kind of a vetting that can be done so that the schools don't have all, they can't do all the checks. So if he's coming through some kind of a centralized this for Islamic schools, maybe that can work. Okay, again, shortage of time. So we'll move on to the next part of it. What do you do? Because recently I came across a case in Mumbai that the physical teacher was accused, true or not lover, was accused of sexual abuse of a girl child. And the first reaction of the school was to deny it. They went into the defense. They said, we have CCTV cameras and we know the teacher and he cannot do it and so on. Ultimately, it turned out that the teacher was arrested under POSCO and he, it seems, accepted that something of the kind, and he's in trouble. And the school is in trouble because they went in a defensive mode. So what is the SOP a school can have, briefly?
It's a very good, relevant question. There are two very, very good laws, draconian laws, okay, crooked draconian. One is the POSCO and another is Child Abuse Protection Act. And both are applicable to the schools because they have children in the school. Now, end of the day, it is the head of the institution which gets into problem. Okay, so more so it requires you to be little more alert. Now, yes, this case, what you're saying, it has happened in many schools where not only the person who has committed that heinous crime has got arrested, also the head of the institute got arrested. Okay, so first thing, please avoid denying. That's the first thing that you will do a favor on yourself. If anything, even the slightest thing you hear, accept the fact and start investigation, and please immediately go and report to the police. The more you deny, the more you get into trouble. And I've seen one of my very good friends also, which Afi, you also know, who became part of it, and till even after 4 years he's suffering, although not being part of it, just because one staff in his school did it. Okay, so it's only way is be alert, very dangerous to acts, not dangerous, and I'm sorry to say that, but very stringent to acts are there, which can put you into very big trouble with the POSCO and the Child Protection Act. So you have to be very careful. The only solution here is to be alert. No. Again, like what I said in the beginning, cameras, CCTVs will not help you in solving this problem. You have to be alert, and being an head of the situation, it's a lot more, the onus is on you.
Right, so we have again scope for developing some kind of a SOP as a guideline for the schools, which can be passed on to all the schools, what they should do in such a situation, how they're supposed to. This is work which needs to be done. Dr. Sayed, in your...
You can get those, two things you can do, a Google search, or if you can send me a mail, sami@manipal.com. I have all the records of POSCO and Child Protection Act. So if it's Google, you can easily get. If you're not, then please send me a mail, I can send you all the rest. At least the act part I can send you.
Right, and then that can further go on to become an SOP for schools. Right. Dr. Sayed, in your experience.
Again, you take the help of the statistics and research-based data. We all think that, you know, when the sexual exploitation
happens, so what should we, how should
we talk about? We think that it is only about girl child. Surprisingly, the sexual exploitation of boys is more than the girl child. It's 39% girl child and 49% boys is they are being exploited. Okay. 10 to 15% children go to hospital during exams. This is also another exploitation. Okay. Now, this I take this opportunity before these esteemed here intellectuals and educationists that you take this as a subject of society.
Right.
Okay. I enter any non-Muslim school. I say that I am going to conduct a class on emotional intelligence, okay, on the subject and the social evils, they welcome you. Be it Azim Premji University, NCERT, National Institute for Peace and Value Education, there are so many institutes. Now we are just having preliminary meetings, going to conduct a big program in Sri Sri Ravi Shankar Ashram. With the help of all these people, we are inviting education minister also there, only on this subject. Peace and value education, the non-Muslims are more concerned about their children on this subject. So we need to take this issue as a dawa. Go to schools, non-Muslim schools. See, we will guide you. Okay? We will help you. How to overcome the children, how to treat your children, how to make your children addict-free. Okay, how to save your children from sexual exploitation, they welcome you.
Right. So it's an important area of work,
yes,
that Muslims,
yes,
can do it as,
yes,
well. That's an important point. Brother Asad, what do you do?
Yeah, in my experience, what I would do is, one is, I'll give you a practical experience about it happened to me, not on child abuse, but it was in background check. So before coming to that, what happened was, one teacher who got resigned from her, she resigned from her school. And what she has done is, she has taken her letterhead, she has made a letterhead on her own, she put some numbers, and she has put a resume experience letter, created resume letter, experience certificate, then she has applied the job. So suddenly we are getting a call from an agency asking us, did she work in the institution? Then we are astonished to know that she has produced a letterhead, that who is doing this? This is Muslims. And we are so much known, how come she has created a letter, signed everything.
Okay, how is it related?
How it is, we should have an agency, background check, as Islamic schools, when Sami sir was talking about background check, every staff should be checking it, number one. Number two, when you speak to a person or who does a child abuse or anything, you will feel the symptoms. The person who talks, the way he behaves, his personality will show you how he is, number two. Number three, any crime, anything, there is a planned crime. It is not spontaneous. No abuse is spontaneous. If everything is planned, they know when the child will be alone, they know when the child will do what to do, right? Number three. Number four, if you have CCTV and there is a software which will know, if you put the video on that software, it will show when he has planned, how he has planned, second by second. How he has planned very well. So that is how the software will how the planning has gone in. Number two. Number four, the culture of the school again, the value system. I used to interact with a lot of non-Muslim educationists. I see the value is not different for them. For us, values are different. So somebody is speaking about good touch and bad touch, and they did see. If you see the videos, how they come up with the good touch and bad touch, you will not sit and see. But Islam has very clearly said, haya is a part of iman, right? If the value system is not there in the school, and if value system is not the school, then I think it's a big problem in our schools. Number five, any person who does child abuse or speaks, whether it's sexual exploitation or any abuse, especially sexual abuse, they are prone to pornography, they are prone to videos which is not allowed. So that the whole, if you observe Allah, if you are in the organization, the how he behaves in organization can easily clear out this person is not the right person for us. So for that culture, our culture of the school should be very strong enough that sends signals. And no person who want this, this happens when you give a lot of free time to the children, free time to the staff. So if you are very clear on your vision, mission and your procedures and everything, I think these unwanted people will not come into your organization. They will not come. These people, they have their own mindset. They don't want to teach. They don't want to learn. Then why they are in the school?
Ashok, so I think a lot of very, very important points I think have come forth in terms of prevention and control and how do you react. And in the meanwhile, inshallah, as you can see, the panelists, mashallah, are quite aware and capable of giving you some inputs and ideas. So you can share during the breaks, to share your emails with them, and they can inshallah in turn pass on what knowledge and information they have. So this can be a networking exercise. Okay, your question.
Yeah, I'm a child psychologist.
Right.
See, preventive is all of us know that preventive is the best thing. Post which is always not good. Normally, as per the research that I have, majority of the abuses in a school happens from the staff. Okay, majority. Very minor is between the senior and junior children or class. Very, very minor, but majority happens from the staff. Now, that's the first question. The second question was, what is the
how to identify that this abuse has happened?
Preventive is what I've said. Having SOPs very clearly laid out, that is a preventive. How to identify this? Raza was saying, ki have a software which can keep tracking what kind of staff that you have and how they are behaving. So that's one kind, and keeping yourself alert. Like again, brother, as I said, it is very relevant that your culture of the school should be so strong that, you know, transparency is allowed. Any person who feels something wrong is going on can be approached, you know, a head of the institution or a principal is approachable. Like anyone can walk in and say something is going wrong there. So in a transparent way. So what I have seen is the best job done was, you yourself are a clinical child psychologist, is the counselors, is what I have seen. So that's my experience.
Dr. Singh, would you like to say
something? I think what I have understood from the question is, who is doing it? Was it the question?
Yeah. That was a question.
Who is doing it?
We have not spoken about the misuse and the use. So only if I say about abuse, who is abusing the child in the school? Are we talking only to the limits of campus of the school? If it is that in the campus, then my question is only to the campus. Who is abusing the child? And how will we identify the child? Supposing the child was yesterday.
Yes.
Today morning, how do I identify?
Yes.
Who is going to address that problem?
Usually it happens on the age group as a part of ranking. a new student join, okay, the class, the senior ones, they rag and they misuse and they abuse. Boys abuse boys. Some girls, you know, age of 9th standard, they abuse the boys of 7th standard. It's vice versa. It's not the age factor.
Who,
yes, it's many factors. And it happens, it's not only in schools. See, it is very common. It has come in the newspaper that during this Holi, lot of girls, high school girls get pregnant during these festivals and then these programs, even in annual day functions, whenever they are allowed to go outside for the, you know, picnic, they also get exploited during these times. So it's even also possible that even at home, as he rightly, even the case study, it happens at home by the relatives. So how to protect, how to identify? You need to understand their body language, children's body language, your daughter's body language, your son's body language, how do these change in this, their appearance have changed, their emotions have changed, their style has changed, they will be disturbed. So you need to identify that way.
So child behavior has to be constantly monitored by the counselors. That's the brief answer to it. Again, this is a wide subject. So I hope that answers the question.
Yeah.
Yeah, brothers, you would like to add on that?
When it comes to abuse, to identify the abuse, we should know what is abuse, by the way. Right? Dr. Sahib sir was speaking about the ragging part. Yes, ragging is also an abuse. Child's exploitation is also abuse. Parent neglecting the child is also abuse. Right? This is one. Number two, the definition according to the law, abuse is not clearly defined. It is the state different. It is the culture different. For example, in America, shaking the hand is not a problem with the girls. But in Islamic school here, shaking the hand is an abuse. Right? So it differs from culture to culture, and exactly law has very clearly told, as long as the child feels that it is abuse, that's it.
Okay, so we'll just take a conclusion on this, because this is a topic that can go on and on. And just recent, Brother Asmat wanted to add something.
No, I think I'm allowed already. Brother, you mentioned shaking hand of a girl with a boy is abuse. It's a wrong thing to communicate. It's not really an abuse, it's a violation of our principles. It's not an abuse. Abuse, the word abuse, the definition, it doesn't qualify to term that as abuse. This is my observation.
Yes, sir. I think we'll take that.
Yeah, I can agree with that, but that's what I don't know. The value, abuse is not clearly defined in the law. Whether you take in international law, whether in Indian law, it is not clearly defined, as long as the child feels. So it's up to the interpretation of the.
Because abuse is associated with what we know it's associated with, so we can't apply that to everything, which rightly pointed out is more of a violation than abuse. And just to briefly tell you about, see, child behavior makes a big difference. A case we recently came across in Mumbai, the boy child, he became withdrawn, he became silent, and when they questioned him, it was found out that the male teacher has abused the child. Okay, so child behavior, study of it, is an ongoing process in schools that the school management should take care of. So that is what you have, inshallah, identified. How do you recognize child abuse happening in your school? So barakallahu feek, all the three panelists, some good inputs, and I think a very good discussion on a very sensitive topic. So with that, we conclude this part of the session.
Okay,